homiletics class was to do a Christmas homily. Homily in the African American persuasion means short sermon. That's what it means. But actually, it's a short sermon with a big message. Many of us, all we know of Christmas is what you gonna get me, Secret Santa, Christmas tree, and from the womb we train our kids to start begging. What we gonna get and how much it costs. In commercializing Christmas, we take that time to buy our children high dollar items that we can't afford, to see a smile on their face for 2 minutes, and they're different. They don't look and say, wow, thank you, Mama, thank you, Santa Claus. They start inventorying what they don't have. So Nintendo is not in here? That's what you're saying? Because Christmas is all about me. But for church folk, say church folk.
Church folk.
Every one of us could probably tell the Christmas story that Ebony just read, and we should know it well. We hear it at least once a year. A young virgin named Mary conceives a child by the Holy Spirit that's above our ability to comprehend. Say amen.
Amen.
She's a young girl that's probably about 12 or 13 years old. And she's engaged to Joseph. In that culture, you're engaged, your spouse is picked out at birth. Wouldn't that be wonderful if you could pick your child's spouse at birth? You need to be saved in order to be spouse for your child, you do know that. Because you got to see him through the eyes of God. Mary's spouse was chosen for her, and in Jewish tradition, once they become engaged, it's technically legal. It's a legal and binding contract. We broke our engagement. No, it's no breaking of the engagement.
Sure. Amen.
Amen.
You're legally married. Only thing that has not happened is you're not consummated that relationship. You act as husband and wife. Your parents have already paid the price for you to be married. And marriage was a financial arrangement because one household was losing somebody and the next household was gaining somebody. So you paid for your spouse. So this is why sorry women didn't get married. Broke daddy, can't pay, no, what is required to make your wife. Say amen.
Amen.
So Mary's engaged. Everything has happened. This is her husband in our mindset. But things happen. She's engaged. Joseph travels to Bethlehem by the order of the emperor. And in this culture, you went to your place of birth, your home church, to be counted. The census, the counting of people was never God's idea. That was man's idea. But they had an order to the count. If you're alive, you participated in a census. And I remember going back when we went through ancestors.com, my sisters were trying to find out our history. They were able to go in the census and find out, because my parents didn't have birth certificates. And so when the census taker would come to your house in 1926, in 1927, they weren't that literate. And so we looked at the census that was taken in 1928, and it says, little girl. is in the house. There were several children in the house, but we figured out which one. My mother was the youngest, and that was her in the census. This is how we were able to find out her age. She was two in 1928. That means she was born in 1926. This is the same way we get our information today, because as we read through the quarters of time, we get some guesstimations, not actual dates. And so they had to travel to Bethlehem, the city of David, and Mary was from the city of David. Say amen. Amen. Well, traveling there, the hotels was full. Now, when I say the hotels was full, the inns were full. This is where people, they had places where you could sleep. They had the spirit of hospitality. You didn't have an option to invite people into your home during the census. We can't do that today. I've tried. I'm telling you, can't do. You can't let folks in your house. It don't work out good. And so what happens was, after everything was filled up, there was no room in the inns. Joseph had to put his family in a feeding trough, in a barn, a cave, so to speak. This is the Christmas story, because we think everything is glamorous and beautiful when you see the nativity is cleaned up, but this was not a pretty story. Say amen.
Amen.
Mary gives birth in a manger. It's where the animals eat from. The heavenly lights flood the earth. God opened up the heavens when the sun came. You know how the same thing that we get baby showers. We have a baby shower. How many of y'all have ever had a baby shower? Have ever been to one? It's a big deal. Now this is God's baby shower. The heavenly lights. And in Jewish tradition, when a baby was born, the whole community came around and they sang songs for the baby. But since he was out of place and he was in a manger in a cave, God has to do strange things when it comes to his child. I'm his child, so he'll do the most when it comes to me. He'll do the most when it comes to you. Have you ever had God to do something just spectacular?
Amen.
Amen.
You know he didn't deserve it, but he did it anyway.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
And so, the heavenly lights flood the earth. The angels announced the good news. And when good news came, the shepherds, they leave the field and their flock to come and see a newborn baby. Everyone is praising God. And for many of us, that's just the extent of a Christmas story. However, that's not the only part of the story that we need to know.
Amen.
There's another part of this story that we don't even hear about. And that's the part of the story when the angels stop singing. Amen? And they go back into heaven. And the shepherds return to look over their flock. And at some point, Mary and Joseph would gather up their things and their baby and travel back home to Nazareth. And this is the part of the story that we don't read about. The manger is empty. The night sky is dark and silent again. And the shepherds just doing their job. They have gone back to work. Say, gone back to work.
Gone back to work.
But that don't end, that does not end Christmas, y'all. A lot of times we take it up so high for a holiday that when it's over, it's a down and we're waiting on the next high. But Christmas never stops, y'all. Say it never stops.
It never stops.
Christmas really begins when we quit talking about the story and allow our lives to become the story. He came from heaven to earth. Show me the way. From the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, then from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. In a couple of days, this tree is going to come down. And our family and friends, everybody sitting around eating, they're going to go back home. All the leftovers are going to be either eaten or thrown in the trash. Decorations, unless you're like your mom who used to keep them up to February, but
amen.
The decorations
amen.
Are going to come. You know, when you find people who take the tree and start putting hearts on it for February, that's a new level of sorry.
Amen.
I don't care. It's a new level of sorry.
Amen.
That's not blessed, that's sorry. Say amen. So decorations will come down. Then the mailman is going to be your enemy.
Yeah.
You're going to start bringing them
bills
in.
Mm-hmm.
Kids are going to go back to school, show off their new clothes, and about a week into January, you won't even know they were new. Parents, like myself, I'll be back to work in the best month of the year. And just like the shepherds, return to their flocks, our lives and our routine will be just like it was before the birth of Jesus. But looks can be deceiving, y'all. Who would ever guess that God would become human flesh with blood, skin, hair, a body just like ours? Who would have imagined that a young virgin would give God human life? Who would have thought that our Savior, the Messiah, the Mashiach, the Lord, the Christos, the one who we have waited for? You have to put on the mind of Israel. They were waiting on their Redeemer to come to avenge them against oppression, and he comes as a baby. What this baby gonna do? God don't think like us. The Bible says thoughts are above our thoughts. And his ways are above our ways. We need to hear and trust the other part of the story. It tells us about the miracle of Christmas. And the miracle is just not the virgin birth, the heavenly lights, the angelic appearance. That's just not the miracle. The songs of a heavenly choir. The miracle of Christmas is in us. The invisible God is seen in a human face. Some people don't see God until they see him in you. The miracle of Christmas is the eternal word of God spoken by human beings. A sacred touch from God comes through the touch of man. The miracle of Christmas is when God exchanged the gift. He gave us divinity, and he took on humanity. And we become who people get to know God through. We're not gods, but people would never know God until they see God in action in our lives. So Christmas is over. All this happens, Luke tells us, in the most ordinary of places and circumstances. We're looking for something big to happen. We want God spoke to me, and this, that, and the third, and the light, my room was spinning around, and the lights came on. God acts in ordinary places. He speaks to ordinary people.
Amen.
Shepherds were considered to be the lowly of all Jewish culture. But when God appeared, the shepherds were one of the first people to see the Savior. And so I'm telling you, God allows things to happen. We need to hear the other part of the story. Christmas as I know it has changed. Say change. I'm helping y'all for next year. You got it, especially when you have small children. You can train them on this commercial Christmas, or you can teach them the real meaning of a season. There's nothing wrong with gifts. But at some point, we got to change our mindset. Luke tells us the most ordinary of places and circumstances that Jesus appeared. It happens even as the government ordered a census and taxation. The government calls the census. God didn't change his plan because there was a census and a taxation. In the midst of travel and crowds of people going to their birth land, overbooked motels, the darkness and the fear of not knowing the future, a baby is born. And it happens while on the night shift. Jesus' birth did not take the shepherds out of the field or away from the sheep. Before Jesus was born, they were shepherds living in the field, keeping their watch over their flock by night. After Jesus was born, they were shepherds in the field, keeping their watch over the flocks by night. After Jesus was born, nothing changed in the lives of people, but their life was changed by his birth. Jesus' birth does not allow us to escape the realities of life. In other words, once you get saved, everything ain't just going to be all right just because you're saved. We're looking, I'm saved, I take my tithes, and I'm experiencing hardship. So what? It doesn't change the realities of life. That's a prison inmate mindset. Every inmate, if you sit around them long enough and talk, you hear the same identical conversation. Well, I'm believing God to get out. I ain't doing no 10 years. Why not? That's what the government gave. If you get out one day, go to 10 years, he's just been good.
Amen.
You don't need to keep praying about the 10 years. If he gave you a life sentence, and every person doing life walk out of there but you, in 20 years, he's still been good, because life means what?
Life.
It doesn't change your reality. I used to get locked up and start praying. Lord, I just need the judge to get sick. Lord, let his wife die. It was that serious for me. Because I wanted God to change my reality. And in reality, I had committed a crime that I had to answer for. And what I really needed to be praying for is for God to have mercy on me. Amen. Say amen.
Amen.
So Jesus is born. But there is no place you can go or circumstances that you can encounter that Jesus is not there. Look at your life. What do you see? Everybody close their eyes. Name your reality, whatever it might be, because that's the place in which Jesus is being born. In your life, a place where God's divinity meets your humanity. He is born in the joys, celebrations, and the thanksgivings of your life, and he is born in the sorrows, the losses, the trouble, the grief in your life. He's born in times of hope, in times of fear. He's born in times of words. And in times of silence, he's born in your successes and your accomplishments, as well as your failures and your disappointments. He is born in times of heavenly transcendence, as well as earthly imminence. The salvation of God's presence, love, and healing fills every aspect of your life. He is born in this Christmas season. So as the angels depart and the shepherds return to their field and the sky become dark again, let the Holy Family go home, because Christmas is real. It has nothing to do with Santa Claus or ho, ho, ho. The manger of his birth is in Bethlehem. But your life is the manger of Jesus. That means that when you let him in, even after all the glitz passed, he is still there. I don't know about you, but to me, that's the best news in the world. And so when the songwriters start to write the song, we think it's an occasion. Oh, come, let us adore him. We think we need to look at Jesus, thank God for the Savior, and go, no, when we adore him in every area of our life.
Amen.
Amen.
Do you worship God in the good times and not in the bad? Is he only God over the good and not God over the bad? Job understood it even better. Though he slay me, yet will I trust in him. And so after the tree is down, after the turkey, and we done changed the tradition, we eating ribs and seafood and whatever. After all that's gone, I'm a traditional type of girl. We have some dressing, I don't know. After everything is gone, where is Jesus in your life? It would be a shame and a disgrace, and I said it earlier, for this to be the day that we celebrate him, his birth, but we don't come and adore him. It'd be a shame and a disgrace to go into 2018 and just take down the tree and the heavenly choir go back into the heavens and the lights dim and we don't allow Jesus to be a part of our life. I don't know about you, but I understand the word of God when it says he comes in the volume of the book. Every year I'm learning more and more about who he is and who I am in his little dot, the dot that I am in the real big picture of things. January 13th, I'll celebrate my 59th birthday. And if somebody brings me a gift, I'll be glad about it. If I get a shout out on Facebook, that'll be good because it's my day. But I share that day with many people. The day of Jesus' birth has never been given to us. And I think that's been done on purpose. Not because there's a confusion or nobody knows. That's not important. That day of his birth is not as important as what happens after he has come.
Amen.
If his birthday is just like my birthday, the 14th of January, I'm telling somebody else happy birthday, and it means my birthday is just lost in the abyss of days. But Jesus coming means everything for you. They waited for a Savior. They knew back in Genesis that God was going to send somebody. They had a picture of who he would be. They looked at him as a warrior who's coming to redeem Israel with signs and wonders. But he came as a baby. The Bible said wrapped and swaddled in clothing. It's not a beautiful blue baby blanket. It's strips where they made him tight because that was ancient custom, Oriental custom. To keep that baby's spine straight and make his body stronger if they wrapped him real tight. Didn't think it was robbery to lie him in a manger. And the manger was how he referred to himself. He was the bread of life. You feed from it. You can come and eat and hunger no more. Put him in a feeding trough so that we can feed off of him.
All right.
I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the true vine. I'm the bread. And the manger, because you can look down in it, as we sing, come let us adore him. Adore him in your life, in your behavior, in your dealings, in every area of your life. Jesus is supposed to be seen high lifted up. Jesus is supposed to be seen in your texts, your Facebook posts, your emails. Jesus is supposed to be seen in your personal dealings, your thought life, your inboxes. Jesus is supposed to be seen in your behavior, in your living, in your giving. Jesus is supposed to be seen in how you treat your neighbor, how you work on your job. Jesus is supposed to be seen in your child support and how you take care of your children. Amen. Jesus, he's not just here today and tomorrow, everything is forgotten. Jesus is supposed to be seen in every area of your life. We're supposed to be givers. We're supposed to be lenders and not borrowers. We're supposed to live a life that's different from the lost and dying world. He came from heaven to earth to show us the way. And once we know that way, we're responsible for the knowledge that we have. We can't keep sinning that grace may abound. My young people, there should be not another unwed mother in this house, because Jesus showed us the way.
Amen.
Say amen. They ain't going to see it in the house. I'm just making them to remember that, because they're struggling with these little children. And right now they don't know they're struggling because the baby is little and don't need nothing. But when your 13 and 15 year old walk into a pawn shop and kill a man, you don't think you need no help? When you don't know where your child is when they're supposed to be at school.
Yes.
Amen.
You don't think you need no help? He came for those reasons. And so as we come to adore him and put away all of the trimmings of Christmas, let us not forget our life is in the manger of Jesus Christ. As the angel said, it's good news of great joy. Let us pray. The manger is not in Bethlehem. The manger is in our lives. And so, Lord, let us not forget the Christmas story, the after story. After everything, all the lights go out, Lord, let us not forget you. Let us not forget how to conduct ourselves in community. Let us not forget those who are in prison. Let us not forget those who take the gospel to the four corners of the earth. Let us not forget to bless those who teach us. Let us not forget how to walk upright, circumspectly before man and before God. Let us not forget how to treat our fellow man. Let us not forget to forgive. Let us not forget to love. Let us not forget that we're representative of you. And even as you punished David, you didn't punish David for his sin with Bathsheba. You said you gave the enemy an opportunity to blaspheme the name of the Lord. Let us not give the devil an opportunity to say God ain't real because of how I act. Let us not give the enemy an opportunity to blaspheme his name this Christmas season. There's anybody here who don't know him in the pre-part of their sin, who just know the Christmas story but not the God of the Christmas story, I invite you to come to the front. Only if the Spirit of the Lord